Hi folks, this is Glenn Guy, your travel photography guru. Today's tutorial is called Photographing Ice and Snow. We're going to be visiting some pretty spectacular parts of the world where the photos are made at varying times of day and under varying weather conditions. So hopefully that'll provide you with a good introduction to the topic. I will deal with some technical issues as we go, but predominantly, this talk's going to deal with another approach, really, to photography, what's beyond the technical. And I want, in particular, to explore the notion of storytelling in our photography. So, in fact, with this picture in question, we could actually be asking ourselves the question, what is it to be an iceberg? I made this photograph of a giant iceberg under the midnight sun during a cruise I undertook on the Ilulissat ice fjord in western Greenland. It's a spectacular location. The ice fjord itself is huge, so this is just a small component. So what I did in this case was I tried to get as low as I could, as close to the waterline as possible when I made the picture, the idea being that it would highlight the size and scale of the iceberg in question. I also waited until the ship I was on was turning around to the side so that I could photograph the iceberg with side lighting, because when light hits the surface from the side, it brings out shape and texture. And you'll notice too that a part of the iceberg is in shade, so the color of the iceberg changes. You've got the beautiful warm light of the midnight sun hitting most of the iceberg, and yet on the other side you've got the cool blue, a lot of which is being reflected from a blue sky above, and then of course reflecting that color off the water as well. So, you know, it's got color contrast, it's got texture, which is enhanced by the angle of the light. So how does this tell the story? Well, I mean, it tells a number of stories. The ones I've just mentioned, for instance, it allows us to explore color and color relationships and texture. They're all parts of the story of the picture. But at a deeper level, what it is to be an iceberg. It's about decay, it's about frozen water, and it's about the effect that sunlight and heat has on frozen water over time, and how through decay, beauty is created. So what's a photograph to you? Well, I suspect it depends how long you look at it and what stories from your own life you bring to the reading of that photograph. But my tip always is the longer you look, the more you see, the greater the reward. At the same location, this photograph really explores color, the color of the iceberg itself lit by the midnight sun and its relationship with the blue sky. So, you know, the yellow is particularly strong in color because of the contrasting blue in the sky. Also, I've made sure I've photographed it from an angle to bring out the texture that was already existing in the iceberg. So it's a photo of an iceberg, but from my point of view, it's really a photograph of color relationships, of texture, and of course of light. Same location. So you see three quite different shots, all made within a very short period of time from each other. In this case, it was the shape of that middle iceberg, you know, the one that looks like it's turned upside down. It's a upside down triangle. That's in fact what drew me to this image. And whilst it looks quite good in color, it's the shape that is more dominant when we've removed the color from the picture. So that's why it's black and white, predominantly because of that triangular shape and the way, like, you know, that these sort of huge chunks of ice have been squeezed in together. I found that fascinating. That's what drew my attention. So that's really what the photograph's of. It's of a triangle and its position in that ice field. Well, space and tranquility, for me, that's what this photo's about. Now we're at the other side of the planet here, down in Antarctica, in a really beautiful, calm bay. The light's quite mournful. The color of the light is quite mournful, and that has a certain charm to it as well. If for those of you like me who have a I guess recognize the beauty of melancholy without spending our whole life in that place. But it's a very beautiful, very quiet sort of emotion I feel, and it's very much how you feel in a place like this because you're really in the wilderness. Now, a lot of my photographs in the landscape deal with what it is to be on the edge of wilderness, but in this case, you're pretty much immersed in it. It's made from a zodiac, pretty much on the waterline, and I'm exploring the color and the shapes and the space. So that's what I think about when I make the picture. It just happens to be ice and snow. That is that's what that most people would refer to as the subject matter. But from my point of view is they're really more objects. The subject of the picture is what I've previously spoken about. The light, the color, the shapes, the sense of space. Tranquility, that's actually the subject matter of the picture. And if you're attuned to these things, it's simply when you're in the landscape, it's simply then a matter of using your nous and the equipment available to you to be able to explore those things. So, it's a beautiful location, this one. The Lumiere Channel, breaking through some pack ice. And this is just what was remaining of the pack ice as we were nearing the end of the channel. And it was just, a simple matter of working with what was available to me, the monochromatic color of the light, the shape of the ice pack, that circular shape. For me, that's probably the most important aspect of the image, that circular shape. And that's been emphasized by the negative space on the right-hand side of the picture, which is just the water. Interesting how the blues are changing from image to image. So another picture down in Antarctica and just a different quality of light. And you can see the colors. I think that again, the more you look, the more you see, because it's a bit of a mess in some ways, this picture, but it does have some interesting aspects to it. I think the deep ridges of that aqua colored ice. Reflections in the water, that sort of turquoise color of the reflections. I think the more you see, the more you appreciate. It's not one of my favorites, but it's the color that certainly drew my attention. And then you tend to notice those other things after the fact, I think. So this photograph here, this is made in Greenland on an overnight hike. And for me, it's really that notion of living on the edge. So the edge, very much the edge of the wilderness. Now, this part of the country, thank goodness, there aren't any polar bears that would eat you. But it's still a pretty wild environment. Although where I made the picture from, I was only about probably an hour and a half's hike back to the town that I was staying in. But right on the edge of a huge pack of ice on the Ilulissat ice fjord. And how do you photograph the ice? It's pretty hard to be on it and move around on it. You could get to other areas of the ice fjord and move around on a boat, which I showed you previously, those images. Or you can actually document the iceberg and its relationship with the land. And in this case, I've used this small stream of water coming down from the hillside, this little pool of water, and tried to connect it with the middle of the image, which is the part of the sea that hasn't frozen, because it appears to be about the same size, doesn't it? It's not. It's just by using a wide-angle lens up close, it exaggerates the size of the water close to the camera. So that's just a bit of a trick to try to find a similarity between the earth and the ice, if you like. And that helps to tie the two of them in together. It's the same notion here, living on the edge. And I've framed it in such a way, I've tried to have just a little bit of space between the rocks and the ice. There is a little bit of distance in reality between the two, but because of the way I've made the image, I've just included that tiny slither to give a sense of separation. But at the same time, it's as though the ice and rocks are being pushed up against each other. And that kind of tension was interesting to me in the making of this picture. Of course, it's really about the quality and color of the light, the beautiful soft light on the ice, and the gentle pinks and blues and turquoise colors. But ice isn't always, it's a bit like mountain tops. They're not always those spectacular triangular peaks. Sometimes they're just kind of blobs, and the shapes don't always work to your advantage. So this image is a little more complex than I'd prefer. I think if anything, what saves it is the lovely pink of the sky and the little bit of water in the foreground. It's interesting because the shape of that water kind of ties in with some of the shapes of the icebergs, I think, as well. Here we are in Iceland. The country that I've enjoyed photographing the most as far as landscape's concerned. I'm very, very keen to get back there as soon as possible. Hopefully I'll be going mid-2015. But it's spectacular. So for me, this image is it's really about the transition of time, because we've got the blue light on the left of the image and the warm pink light on the right. So in fact, the dawn is giving way to the rising sun. And these sort of transitions occur in weather as well. Rain to sunlight, vice versa. Light to dark. And as we saw before, ground to ice. Any sort of opposites, I think, is a really interesting notion to explore in our photography. And it doesn't have to be the most common thing that's going on in your photographs, but it's there nevertheless. And that might be the style that you end up developing over time. You find, oh, well, what is there that's similar about the photographs I make? And with a little bit of editing and resequencing of your images, you'll realize that in fact a style does exist, and with careful attention to the way you present your images in sequences, that style will then become much more evident. Well, I've shown this image a couple times since I joined the Arcanum, and one of the reasons is I have a great attachment to the photograph. Being at this location, it was quite a journey to get there to make this photograph. I love the fact that we have a party tree, if you like, in the middle of the image, and it's huge, but it's dwarfed by the scenery that surrounds it. So I'd call this a winter Eden. And it was spectacular. I guess my favorite images that I've produced over the years. And as is usually the case, it's not just because of the final result, it's because of the story invested in making the image. Is that transition again from warm to cool, light to dark, made under very trying conditions, that shot. This is over the top of a glacier in western Greenland. And here back in Iceland, you can see the lovely pink as the last warm light of the day touches the mountaintop, and the rest of the scene is bathed in this cool blue light. It's a spectacular place for landscape photography, Iceland. So again, the notion of transitions was heavy in my mind when I made this photograph. And just, the stillness. I mean, I think the trick is, if you're wondering what your photograph's about, I think you really need to ask yourself when you're out in the landscape, how you feel. Because if your photographs are successful, they will be announcing to the world how you feel. They will be exploring the notions of tranquility, serenity, calm, peacefulness, etc., connection that you feel at that moment. It's as simple as that. The photograph is not of an ice lagoon with a mountain top at, you know, under the last light of day. That's really not what it's about. It's about the story that's being told and the emotions that you invest in the image and that people elicit from it when they view it. Just pulling back a little bit to give, the wider view of the scene. And, you know, the warm light has disappeared in this case. It's got a different feel, doesn't it? And you'll notice on the left of the image, about halfway up, I managed to get some guys to take a friend and I out on this large glacial lagoon about midnight at night. You know, they'd gone home several hours earlier, but I managed to get them out again, and we spent an hour or so zooming around taking pictures. It was an absolute highlight of the trip. And I'd recommend it to anyone. So for me, this shot's about light, of course, and it's about weather. And it's as simple as that. Just made off the deck of a ship down off Coverville Island off the Antarctic Peninsula. But that's all it is. And, you know, there's nothing too special, I suppose. We make a lot of photos when we're on ships and things, because the landscape and weather can be spectacular. Some are more successful than others. But if you're aware of what it is that draws your attention and you compose your image about that and you expose with that in mind, then you've got a good chance of realizing a good result, I feel. To me, this photograph is about weight, the weight of the snow on the trees, you know, literally weighing it down. So there's a metaphor, which I think is in a lot of photographs. And for goodness sake, we don't want to be in those horrible corporate boardrooms where they literally have to spell the metaphor out, you know, on the bottom of the print in a tacky frame on the wall where it says inspiration or just do it or something like that. You know, we should be bright enough to be able to look at the image and draw from it for ourselves what we need. Fragility. Now, maybe we will talk about exposure for a moment. I'll make a separate tutorial on this at a later stage, but my approach is to set my camera to raw and I expose to the right. So that means your histogram is as far to the right as possible, without actually touching the far right-hand edge of the histogram. Because if it touches the right-hand edge, it's actually going beyond, and you don't know how far beyond it's gone. So whilst people will say to you, oh yes, you can pull back a half a stop or a whole stop, well, how do you know if you've gone a stop over or two stops over, in which case you probably can't pull some of that detail back. So I really think for folks that the safest thing to do is just to push your data as far to the right as possible without it actually going over the edge. You should also have the the blinkies is the slang term, you know, the highlight warning switched on the LCD on the back of your camera, because what will happen then is if you do reach an area that is being recorded as pure white, it'll flash on and off on the back of your camera. Well, just look at it and say, well, you know, gee whiz, that's the area that's flashing is 2% of my picture. I really don't care if it's pure white because it's so tiny, no one's going to see it. Or it might be, yes, it's a specular glare, like bright light hitting a bumper bar on a car. There's no detail there. It's supposed to be pure white. You know what I mean? It's important to understand the information that is being provided to you. And you expose as far to the right as possible, assuming that doesn't take you into very slow shutter speeds and introduce camera movement. I mean, that would just be silly. Or subject movement where you want the subject to be still. So, you know, you have to bear that stuff in mind as well. But, you know, that's the approach. And the only other thing I'd add to that is that we have three histograms. In most cameras, they'll display three histograms, red, green, and blue, or otherwise what's called the composite histogram, which is the white histogram on a black background. Now, that's easier to work with, but it's problematic. In a lot of photographs, If you bring up the red, green, and blue individual histograms, you'll notice that one of those three colors is further to the right than the others. Whichever color that is, that's the only one you need to be concerned about. So whichever colored histogram is the furthest to the right, that's the one that you base your exposure to the right upon. Forget about the other two. They'll just fall into place. If you move one of them to the right, the other two will also move to the right to the same degree. But you just make sure the one that is already furthest to the right doesn't go beyond the right-hand edge of the histogram. That's the secret. So I hope that makes sense. If you go for the usual white on black, it's actually a composite of the other three. So if you can imagine, for instance, the blue histogram is a little to the left, the green is in the middle, and the red is to the white. The red is to the right. So what do you see? The composite histogram is going to average the three out, and your white on black histogram will appear to be in the center. So what happens then is when you start to move it to the right, you've actually taken the histogram that should have been already to the right, for instance, the red one, over the edge. And that's particularly a problem when you're photographing sunrises and sunsets with really bright, colorful reds and oranges. I hope that makes sense. I'll come back to this in a more technical tutorial down the track. Okay, straightforward landscape, large depth of field, texture, shapes, weather. That's all it is. Bit complex, bit too much going on. But I must admit, coming from the part of the world where I'm from, southeastern Australia, we don't get much snow. In fact, I've got to travel some distance to see it. So I love the notion of trees and leaves covered in that sort of icy snow. I just think that's spectacular. Composition. It's a simple image, and I'm working with the triangle here, the three vertical trees that are linked together invisibly to form a triangle. Triangles, the notion of three is very important in a lot of, well, a lot of religions, a lot of mythology. The Minbari, I've mentioned a few times, from Babylon 5, for them, three is sacred. But it goes back a long, long time in history, the notion of three. Three, in some ways, is a more interesting pairing than two. So this is an image, really, that I suppose could be considered an environmental landscape because it's suggesting protection. But of course, it's protection through barriers. Compositionally, it's structure, I suppose, that underpins this image. The circular shapes of the barriers, and the repetition within them. The star shapes on the left, or triangular shapes on the left, or the strong vertical lines on the right. It's the repetition that actually gives it a sense of balance and solidity, rigidity, if you like. But it's very much an imposed order, isn't it? In what is in nature, which is by definition chaotic. So that's kind of interesting duality too, I think. And here's another fenced off area, not necessarily for protection, it's just who's not drawn to an old decrepit fence, particularly when it's covered in ice crystals. And the fact that if there's a story, oh, you can jump over. I certainly felt like jumping over the fence, don't we all? when we're given an opportunity to, and I realized I would have had footprints in the snow, so I didn't. So for me, this is a sort of Shangri-La image. I'll re explore this down the track. This is pretty realistic, I feel, to the color of the light that was there, but it might be a more successful image if I can get some sort of if I can get some more of an orange hue out of these rocks, a bit like the ones on the right, compared to that sort of, I don't know, reddish magenta, muted colors that we have of the rocks on the left. The other option is to actually bring some warmth into the mist. Well, that's just something I'll explore, but I think it's actually, as gorgeous as it is, I think it's a little bit flat in some ways. Obviously there's what you can do to the image afterwards that is at least as powerful as what you're able to do in camera. Made from the deck of a ship down in Antarctica, and just the light kissing the top of the hillside or the mountainside, it reminded me actually of that little bit of light coming through when Frodo and Samwise are being marched through a landscape on the way. Actually, they're going on the way to Mordor with Gollum, and it's oh look, Mr. Frodo, the king's got a crown, something like that, a crown of flowers, and it was just that momentary moment of hope in an image before the light changed and the reality of the day and the quest was brought back to the boys. So, that's actually what was in my mind when I made this photograph. Well, to me, the reward for getting up really, really early and getting to the location in search of a picture, because this was unknown to me, this location. I was just following one of several pathways I could have chosen on a mountaintop very early in the morning in eastern China. And when I got to this place, I was really pleased to see what appeared to me to be islands arising from a sea of clouds, if you like. So that was kind of special because it's very transitory, isn't it? Because, a few moments earlier, the smaller peaks would not have been visible, they would have been covered. And a few minutes later, the heat of the sun, because the sun had just come up a little bit earlier, the heat of the sun would have dissipated a lot of the cloud cover. So it's an image that exists in a very short period of time. And one of the tricks about being a decent landscape photographer is to be there. And that means getting to the location. That means having an idea about where you're going to go. That means giving up on logic after, initial research and going with a gut instinct, which is sometimes enhanced through experience, but really being sensitive to the light, being sensitive to the conditions, trusting your intuition, having the ability to do the technical stuff in camera within a couple seconds and be ready to make the photograph and just experience the moment. And don't let the making of the picture in camera get in the way of that experience. That's just tragic when that happens. And I think we all experience that in the early days, but once we become familiar with the camera, most of the decisions we're making are almost happening automatically, by which I mean we're still controlling the camera, but you don't really have to think about what it is you're doing. It's just kind of, it's a multitasking thing, and you really need to be in the moment to be able to make the image, I feel. The greatest challenge, I think, for most of us in life is getting out of bed in the morning, particularly when it is to getting out of bed early. So if you're able to get out of bed and get out the door, the world awaits you. I think that's the great lesson for the landscape photographer, or would-be landscape photographer. And don't let the weather stop you, embrace it, because on the edge of weather, that's often when you get the most beautiful light. Well, on the edge of the landscape, I suppose the metaphors here would be hardship, survival. It's a very bleak and difficult landscape these penguins are living on, and just meters from the edge of the water, you can bet there are seals waiting for them. So I think we've all seen those nature programs and wondered how they manage, particularly in the bleak winters. I'm down there in summertime, and I actually we did a landing, a zodiac landing on this part of the island, and just sinking into snow straight away. It was almost waist deep in many cases, and I managed to walk a very short distance but still made a whole lot of photographs because it's just such an extremely attractive landscape, but not pictorial. You know, it's a hard land and a wild landscape, but you know, it has its own beauty, of course. And I think the scale adds to that in this case. Really, just in the same bay that previous image was made in, that I spoke about, and we have here a seal enjoying itself, sunning itself on a rock, and nevertheless, you look at the landscape that surrounds it. So, of course, it's made for the water, and it is a predator, and a very competent one, but it's still a very, very hard landscape to be in. Well, for me, this image suggests hope. It's been a favorite of mine for some time. This one's made in the Ilulissat Ice Fjord in Western Greenland again, as the fishermen head out. And the view of the township towards the end of that overnight hike I did. And you can see part of the ice fjord below. It's not far away, Greenland, if you live in, you know, Eastern Canada or Northeast USA. It's not far at all. But from Australia, it's a long, long way. I tacked on a few days there at the end of a Iceland and European trip I did a few years ago. And I'm so glad I did because it's such a different environment compared to, I mean, it's an Arctic environment. It's so different to, what I've grown up in and most of the countries I've been to over the years. You know, the vast majority of my travel experience has been in Asia actually. But on through the Arcanum thus far, I'm really just showing images I've made over recent years, you know, digital camera images, but I've been taking photos for decades. But I hope you get the gist that this image does talk about living on the edge of the wilderness. For better or for worse, you know, how we manage that. Some local Inuit lads doing what all boys like to do, throw rocks into the water. Back down to Antarctica. So this is at a place called Port Lockroy. And it's a there's a science research station there, and just behind it is the accommodation for the folks that are the scientists who live there throughout the year. I think they sign up for a year or more at any time. You might notice way in the background on the right-hand side there's a fairly large rookery of penguins. A nice one for black and white because of the shapes. And the repetition in the corrugated iron, just the yeah the contrast inherent to the image itself. Imagine having one of those gas bottles. Let's say it was blue or orange. It just you know just wouldn't work in a color picture. It'd be overpowering. So calm it down and get back to the elements that are really compositional elements that are really strong. So some photographs in this series, you know, do talk about living on the edge, but how do we navigate our way through a wilderness landscape? You know, how do we pass through it? Well, we pass through it as tourists, sometimes poorly clothed. Quite a surreal image, this. I enjoy this. We pass through it as workers. Very different feel altogether. Same mountain, different place on the mountain, but you know, you have a tourist, just a local tourist, not a particularly well-heeled tourist, a local tourist, moving through the landscape, and then you have a worker who is almost a part of the landscape based on the role he has to fulfill. And just a final couple images. Another approach we can take when we're making photos in such an environment, the Arctic, the Antarctic, is to explore abstraction. It's just a tiny bit of ice floating on water, and I'm in a zodiac, and I've just made a shot dealing with reflections, really. And it's such a simple photograph. And if you do a little bit of this, you'll actually make some really interesting shots over time. It's just a matter of being aware of what's going on and having your camera ready, always adjusting your camera to the lighting and contrast, etc., that is before you. And making choices as to lenses. What's the best lens? Why I'm out here in the middle of the lagoon, or as I get closer to the ice, do I need to change lenses so I'm ready to make the shot? Or if it's a zoom lens, should I be at the tele end or the wide end? Make a lot of those decisions. What should the ISO be to give me the shutter speed I need to be able to make a fast enough picture whilst traveling on a moving zodiac? You're making all these decisions before you bring the camera up to your eye, because you only have that moment to make the photo and then it's gone. Back on Huangshan, Yellow Mountain, my journey there, which lasted three days, was w one of the best times of my life. I celebrated my birthday actually at the time, and it was overcast for all but a few minutes. The light was spectacular. But this is a very different image, and of working with abstraction, I was really just celebrating the fact the sun had come out, because it was minus 20 at times during that stay, and the sun had come out, and we could see some warm colors and the cool blue sky contrasting with it. But yet it was only transitory, because a moment later it was covered by mist. So I played with that idea and focused on the ice crystals in the foreground on the right-hand side of the picture, and tried to suggest that notion that, things reveal themselves and then are removed from view. It's that whole notion of Shangri-La again, I feel. So I hope you've enjoyed this presentation, folks. We did delve into one or two technical issues along the way. But mostly it's about the notion of storytelling, and I suppose a stylistic approach to photography. And the word style spooks a lot of people, because it's a very difficult word to define. But hopefully I've given you some ideas through this presentation as to how you might go about discovering your own style. So thanks so much. This is Glenn Guy, your travel photography guru, and I look forward to sharing more images and more ideas of you in an upcoming tutorial. Thanks, and bye for now.